God's words to it to try to get a feeling of God's presence. God's presence is not in the type of music, it's in the type of attitude. This song is very powerful because it says, "Let me be overcome by your presence." That doesn't mean I'm going to feel goosebumps or chills or my hair stand up on the back of my neck. It means I've decided to acknowledge his presence beyond my emotional perspective. I used to watch people, in fact, I see Muslims on the street downtown at the hour of a prayer lay down a carpet and pray. They're not doing that because they feel something emotional. They do that because they're acknowledging in their faith the presence of Allah. If we go to the presence of a king in the natural, I don't just bow down because I feel emotional about him being king. I respect and acknowledge his presence beyond my feelings. Here's one of the weaknesses of worship in the Western world, is we're waiting for God's presence to overtake our emotions. Are you following me? And so we create ministries that move our emotions and call that the presence of God. When sometimes the presence of God is absolutely zero line on the emotions, but still a decision to acknowledge his presence to overcome my carnal expectations. Now, this is not, you're not going to pack out mega churches with that mindset, because they're going to gather to a band, a presentation. And I'm not saying that that's evil. I'm just saying it's a misconception of what worship is. When we do the Trisagion now, it's a different sound, but it's an acknowledgement of his presence. Holy Spirit is here whether we acknowledge him or not. When I choose to acknowledge him, I'm being overtaken by his presence beyond my mental understanding. And that's the problem with this next generation leaders, is that we're trying to create for them a concert experience. That's not going to help you when you're at your worst moment of temptation. You can't go plug in a CD and say the presence of God is here. We go through this part of the service all the time, the Trisagion and the music and worship, and we come into church casual. We come in with our, you know, our appetites being satisfied. But I want to just admonish you this morning. Is everybody with me here? Is everybody following me? You're never going to feel it long enough or consistently enough to stay faithful to it. You're never going to feel it long enough. You may feel it at moments, and usually that's moments when you're desperate for God to do something. But that doesn't make that worship any more powerful. In fact, I would submit to you that your worship is most powerful when you feel it the least. Your worship is most powerful when you're not having a sensation of his presence. Because then it's out of pure devotion and an act of my will. So if you see me up here with my arms lifted, or a priest, don't ever think in your mind they're feeling something you don't feel. They're probably feeling less than you feel. Sometimes you may look at Bishop worshiping and say, "Oh, Bishop must really be enthroned, engulfed in the presence of God." And I can tell you, I'm battling all of the flatline experiences you are. But that doesn't change my willingness to lift my hands, because his presence is here whether I feel like lifting my hands or not. And this is what instruction in the faith is. I learn to acknowledge his presence in worship, so when I'm out there in the world being tempted, I could acknowledge his presence when I'm thinking of giving in to temptation. Are you here? Everybody, lift your hands right now. Bow your heads. Every person in this place. The feeling of what you're doing is not as important as the demonstration of your acknowledgement of His presence and obedience of His voice from His appointed person, which would be me. It's not, I feel it. It's not, it's overtaken me. So when we do the Trisagion today, I want you to take this sacred posture. When David said, "You have not allowed my enemies to overcome me," we think he was talking about Amalekites and Philistines and that, but he was talking about worldly concepts that take him away from God's presence. Amen? Holy art thou, O God. Holy art thou, Almighty. Holy art thou, Immortal One, crucified for us, have mercy on us. Holy art thou, O God. Holy art thou, mighty. Holy art thou, Immortal One, crucified for us, have mercy on us. Holy art thou, O God. Holy art thou, Almighty. Holy art thou, Immortal One, crucified for us, have mercy on us. Kyrie eleison, Christi eleison. Kyrie eleison. Thank you, Father, for being faithful to keep your presence with us. Even when we disconnect ourselves and plug into worldly emotions and human nature. Today, Lord, help us to discipline ourselves to an attitude of reverence, an attitude of honesty before you. We pray this in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. I want to also say it's awesome to come into the house of God knowing that reverence is not contingent on emotion. Amen. You may be seated. And while I'm on the subject, our next generation, we've tried to make church exciting for them rather than teach them that God is not always exciting, but He's still God. I don't always feel like lifting my hands and being faithful, but He's still God when I don't feel like it. And so the call of the church, going back to our opening prayer, is our reverence begins the moment we leave the house on Sunday morning. It begins Saturday night before we go to bed. It begins Friday afternoon when we're on the job. It's not just something we come to. Going to church cannot change your life. Being the church changes your life. Amen. You may be seated for the Holy Scriptures. I want to thank all the men that came and worked, and ladies. I know there's a few that were here yesterday. Doesn't the property look much, much nicer, much more dignified? This is not Bishop Gregory's property or Mother's property. This is the community of St. Isaac's place of worship. In order to take care of this facility, as big as it is and as small as we are, is not the responsibility of me like an owner of a business. It is the responsibility of every baptized and chrismated member of St. Isaac's. And our dignity and our honor and our integrity is expressed the way we care for things. None of us would allow our front yard to get weeds knee-high in it. None of us would allow holes to be kicked in the wall and not repaired. None of us would allow our roof to leak and destroy our carpet and make our house smell like a musty sulfur sauna somewhere. This is the responsibility of God's people, not just a couple of people. So when you walk up here, you have ownership. You have ownership to the community of St. Isaac's and say, I am a part of something bigger than myself. Amen? Amen.
The Old Testament reading is from the book of Wisdom of Solomon. God did not make death, and he does not delight in the death of the living. For he created all things so that they may exist. The generative forces of the world are wholesome, and there is no destructive poison in them. For the dominion of Hades is not on earth, for righteousness is immortal. God created us for incorruption, and made us in the image of his own eternity. But through the devil's envy, death entered the world, and those who belong to his company experience it.
The epistle reading is from 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verses 7 through 15. As you excel in everything, in faith, in speech, in knowledge, in utmost eagerness, and in our love for you, so we want you to excel also in this generous undertaking. I do not say this as a command, but I am testing the genuineness of your love against the earnestness of others. For you know the generous act of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sakes, he became poor, so that by his poverty you might become rich. And in this matter I am giving my advice. It is appropriate for you who began last year not only to do something, but even to desire to do something. Now finish doing it so that your eagerness may be matched by completing it according to your means. For if the eagerness is there, the gift is acceptable according to what one has, not according to what one does not have. I do not mean that there should be relief for others and pressure on you, but it is a question of a fair balance between your present abundance and their need, so that their abundance may be for your need, in order that there may be a fair balance. As it is written, the one who had much did not have too much. And the one who had little did not have too little. Jesus never thought of himself too highly, and I really admire that about him. He became man. He lowered himself in humility so that all of us could be redeemed. And in doing that, he never compromised who he was or the purpose that he was sent to fulfill, which was to strengthen us, prepare us, the body of Christ. Now, if our desire to meet the needs of others equal the desire to meet our own needs, we'd have fair balance. The scripture says, I do not mean that there should be relief for others and pressure on you, but it is a question of a fair balance between your present abundance and their need, so that their abundance may be for your need. Equal distribution means the weight is not too great for anyone to bear. And that doesn't mean that everyone does the same thing or does the same amount. But there is a shared awareness among us in the spirit of the condition of the whole body. And then there is a desire and a willingness to give and serve sacrificially without expectation. The more we worry about satisfying ourselves, the further we are from serving others. If we trust God to meet our needs, then we can pour into someone else's life selflessly. All of us know people in our lives, beloved, that give very generously of their time, their talent, their resources. We all know these people. And we all know that there's people like that that make sure that everybody knows about it too. Like the scripture said, Jesus became poor so that we could become rich, not in the natural, but in spirit. Jesus didn't need to do this. He wanted to do this because he loves us so much. Jesus didn't tell everybody what he was doing. He didn't tell everybody what he had done or what he was going to do. And that's because he didn't need to. He trusted in God the Father unconditionally. This is the word of the Lord.
Grace and peace be with you all. This is the Holy Gospel of St. Mark this morning. This is also a revelation of what it is to be desperate for God. Desperation, divine desperation, is very important to spiritual life. And so, as I read the Gospel this morning, it's about three different incidences. Two of them are about women who, one had an issue of blood for 12 years and the other was sick for 12 years. 12 being the number of apostolic power. Or, let me put it this way, not the power of an apostle, but the power that comes from apostolic order. Not from an individual, but from a community, okay? When Jesus had crossed again in the boat to the other side, a great crowd gathered around him, and he was by the sea. Then one of the leaders of the synagogue named Jairus came and said, when he saw him, fell at his feet and begged him repeatedly, my little daughter is at the point of death. Come and lay your hands on her so that she may be made well and live. He went with him. A large crowd followed him and pressed in on him. Now there was a woman who had been suffering from hemorrhages for 12 years. In the eyes of the Jews, she'd been suffering from impurity because the menstrual cycle in the eyes of Jews was a sign of impurity, and you could not be in public for 12 years. This is her first time coming out of privacy in 12 years, because it was against the law of the Jews to come out if you had any bleeding or issue of blood. So he endured much under many, she endured much under many physicians, and had spent all that she had, and she was no better, but grew worse. She had heard about Jesus and came up behind him in the crowd and touched his cloak, for she said, "If I but touch his clothes, I will be made well." Immediately her hemorrhage stopped, and she felt in her body that she was healed of her disease. Immediately aware of the power, that the power had gone forth from him, Jesus turned in the crowd and said, "Who touched my clothes?" And his disciples said to him, "You see the crowd pressing in on you. How can you say, 'Who touched me?'" He looked all around to see who had done it. But the woman, knowing what had happened to her, came in fear and trembling, fell down before him, and told him the whole truth. He said to her, "Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace and be healed of your disease." Everybody say, desperate people do desperate things. While he was still speaking, some people came from a leader's house, a leader of the synagogue, to say, "Your daughter is dead. Why trouble the teacher any further?" But overhearing what they said, Jesus said to the leader of the synagogue, "Do not fear, only believe." He allowed no one to follow him except Peter, James, and John, to the brothers of James. When they come to the house of the leader of the synagogue, he saw a commotion, people weeping and wailing loudly. When he had entered, he said to them, "Why do you make a commotion and weep? The child is not dead, but sleeping." Everybody say, God sees things differently. And they laughed at him. They derided him. They mocked him. Then he put them all outside, took the child's father and mother and those who were with him, and went in where the child was. He took her by the hand and said to her, "Tabitha kumai," which means, "Little girl, get up." And immediately the girl got up and began to walk about. She was 12 years of age. And at this they were overcome with amazement. But he strictly ordered them that no one should know this, and told them to give her something to eat. This is the word of the Lord. Happy are they who hear these words, believe them, and obey them. Let us worship the Lord. Father, prepare our hearts today to hear your word in a way we've never heard it before. Challenge us through the power of your Holy Spirit to deal righteously with our numbness towards our spiritual life, towards our apathy regarding your principles and your purpose in our life. We pray this in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Drove by a church in my neighborhood, and they had a very nice sign out there that says, "The purpose, there is no purpose in life without a purpose for life." What's your purpose? What's our purpose? How desperate for God are you? Not how desperate are you to get God to do something for you. How desperate for Him are you? It's a unique question because divine desperation is different than emotional desperation or relational desperation. So a lonely person is desperate for companionship. A financially lacking person is desperate for resources. I'm not talking about that type of desperation today, because we will transition that into being desperate for God to do something to meet those carnal needs. So divine desperation, we saw in today's gospel, is when you're at the end of your ability to fix it. When you're at the end of your ability to repair the problem, and borrowing money, having reputation, having the right physician, we saw that with the woman, doesn't work. For 12 years, she tried to get her problem healed. But because of her desperation for God, it was a very touch of the hem of his garment. Now, before I preach about this, I want to translate something for you. This is going to be unpopular, what I'm going to say, but it's the truth. If we believe that the church is the incarnate physical manifestation of Jesus, and we believe Jesus is God, my question for you is, how desperate are you for the church? Because this is the problem. This is the problem in our culture, is because church is somewhere we attend or tolerate, and there's a difference between being desperate for God and tolerating his existence. I tolerate the existence of God, but I'm not desperate for God, because I'm too busy being desperate for my natural life. And so everything in my natural life controls my stability or instability, because I'm not desperate for God, which means I'm not desperate for his church, which means I'm alienated from the life. The fathers taught us to miss the Eucharist twice is to disconnect yourself from the life of God, because you're disconnecting yourself from the meal of the church. Oh, I know that you don't have, there's a lot of places that'll go, you can go to, that will never preach this. But the bottom line is unless you eat the flesh of the blood of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Let me translate that another way. Lest you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood on a regular, a prescribed basis, according to the apostles, temptation will overtake your desperation for God. You cannot go 6 months, 9 months without his flesh and blood and expect to have the power or the life to fight off temptation, because it is the antidote of the soul. One thing about Jesus' ministry is the further he got into it, the smaller it got, but the more powerful it got. See, in the world, we think we're powerful if we're big. But in God's eyes, You may have to shrivel to be more powerful. Hello, Gideon's army. In our lives, we're not desperate for God to keep us from worldly temptation. We're desperate for God to fix our worldly appetites. As Mar Enoch used to say, you can't buy that in a Bible bookstore, because most people are trying to use God's power for their life. They're not wanting to use their life for God's power. And so we luxuriate. I said this to a pastor this week on the phone. I said, you want to know something? A sermon, this sermon even, does not change your life. You can get a sermon 7 days a week. You can listen to all kinds of sermons on the radio. That isn't going to fix your life. The church isn't about listening to sermons. The church is about connecting yourself to the life of God. Music is not going to change your life. You don't need to come to church to have music. You can put a tape in, a CD or an iPod or whatever, buy it on whatever, anytime, but you cannot shortcut for the sacraments of the church. You can't manufacture your own sacramental life, because there's one cup and one loaf that the church shares in. And so the demonic religious demons over the Western world have convinced people that their personal relationship, so they think, with God is bigger than the life of the church. But Paul said, I fill up in my body what is lacking in the church, because his focus was the well-being of the church. And here's the problem in America, and I'm saying this for to go as far as it can, a bunch of people sitting in chairs who have no care for the church, they just have a care for their desperation for their life. And then we wonder, we hear things like, where's the power of God? See, I think that there's another blessedness. There's a blessed of the desperate. Blessed are the desperate. Blessed are the desperate, for they do not care what anyone thinks. Blessed are the desperate, for they do not care what anyone says. When you get to the point of desperation, other people's opinion of you diminishes quickly. The desperate will go where no one else will go. As long as we have options as to what we can do, we're not desperate. As long as we can orchestrate, how often do you hear this in this day? Do you have a plan for your life? My answer is no, I don't. My only plan is to follow God. God has a plan for my life. I may not like the plan that he has. I may not agree with the plan he has. But I cannot put my appetites into competition with God's plan. You need to have goals. You need to know God can blow your goal up. The minute you go contrary to his purpose for your life, you may have trained for it, studied for it, you may have planned it all out, God will blow it up. Because God will not allow his purpose be thwarted in the name of a plan. Blessed are the desperate. They won't let anything stop. There's a tenacity that comes with desperation. This woman with the issue of blood fought through the crowd. If I could but touch him, I'm out here illegally. I'm issuing blood. If they catch me, they'll stone me to death. The bottom line is, if she would have been caught with that issue of blood in public, they would have taken her to the hilltop and killed her. We're talking about that type of desperation. That I'm so sick of this hemorrhage, I'm so sick of this disease, I'm so sick of this problem that I'm finally ready to sell out. And then we wonder why God allows divine dilemmas in our life. It's to get us to the point of desperation. And so as I preached last week, your divine dilemma is God's way of bringing you to divine desperation. Amen. They won't let anything stop them. They will do desperate things. Over the years, we've had to do desperate things to keep serving God. But desperate times call for desperate measures. And desperate people who are desperate from God have at least the ear to hear from God, you need to sacrifice something. See, here's what the kingdom looks like. By faith, you take care of that which is overwhelmingly bigger than you. For we walk not by sight, but by faith. As long as you're living your life based on what you see and feel, you'll never be able to walk in the kingdom. Because the kingdom is overwhelmingly bigger than us. I'm going somewhere with this. Will you all be desperate with me? Emptiness is the prerequisite for desperation. Now, let me put it this way. I've had people ask me over the years, why do the people seem so empty? Because God's trying to bring them to a point of desperation. When you're empty, you cannot fill that emptiness with worldly stuff, not even another person. Gary Thomas says, you better not love somebody so much that they bring you your fulfillment, because God will put a plan in to mess that relationship up, even if you're married. I will have no other gods before me. God is obligated by his very nature to keep us empty until we let him fill us up. And if we're looking to anyone else, it's too much pressure. You remember that movie? And I've said this before, but I just want to say it again because I like saying it. When that woman says to that man, you complete me, well, you're crazy. Because if any other human can complete you, it's just a matter of time until God drops a bomb in the middle of that thing. It doesn't matter who or what it is. God wants his people desperate for him. Desperation is the condition that exists when a recognized need is present. All of God's people are needy. We're all needy. But few are willing to acknowledge that we're needy. It is when the need is acknowledged that a condition of desperation begins to be developed in us. We need that desperation to be developed in us so that we can stay connected to the purpose of God. God's not sentimental. Jesus was in the Garden of Gethsemane. Son of God, very man of man, very God of very God. He got the point of desperation where he said, Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. He was sweating blood. He was having a nervous breakdown according to medical analysis. And he said, nevertheless, not my will, but thy will be done. But see, most Christians never get to that point. They switch churches, get a new spouse, get a new house, get a new car, get a new job to try to fill that emptiness that only God can fill. And the scary thing is we become content with that emptiness. It's like, I know I'm empty, but I at least got a little something. But there'll never be true peace or true fulfillment until God is the one filling your emptiness. You'll never be a good parent until God is the one filling your emptiness. You'll never be a good spouse. Because see, what we'll do, we'll give our kids what we believe fills us. And if we're not giving them God, we're giving them something that can never fill them. Why desperation? Because there's too many human solutions. Too many human solutions to what I think is going to fulfill me. See, we don't want anyone to tell us anything really about how we should live our lives. We don't want another person telling us. This is why mentorship is only for a few people. Most of us think we know what's best for us and our family. That's delusional. This is why there's an emptiness. We heard it today in the epistle. We heard it in the gospel. We're hearing it today. Most of us don't want to be told how to live our lives. We don't even want God to tell us how to live our lives. And I know that's true, because if we lived our lives the way God told us to live them, our lives would be a lot different than they are. Our lives would look different. Amen? We would not be justifying little tiny foxes that we know are compromised. If we lived a life that God wants us to live, we'd look at the most minute thing in our life and say, I can't be a part of that. I can't touch that. I can't be a part of it because I'm desperate for God. But if you don't eat his flesh and drink his blood, you're not going to stay desperate for God. You cannot survive on a happy meal once a month. Because it's more than the communion. It's more than the bread and the wine. It's more than walking down the aisle here. It's saying, I am connected to the life of God through the church. I am connected to the life of God through what he gave humanity. And I am at war with everybody who says you don't need a local church. I am apostolically at war with you. I don't care what kind of theology you think you have. Jesus gave to his apostles a command and an order to be sustained from generation to generation. And you can conjure up some kind of theology. It's called Gnostic theology. It's new theology that accommodates your own unwillingness to let someone else tell you what to do. If I live for any other reason on this earth, it's to stand up for the life of the church. And the day we take our children away from the life of the church and give them Willie George and give them sports and give them education and give them something other than the life of the church, we're setting the next generation up for failure and weakening God's body, the church. Desperation only comes when there is a recognized need beyond our own ability. Here's a definition of desperate: dangerously reckless or violent, as from urgency or despair. Showing extreme courage, especially if actions courageously undertaken as a last resort. Showing extreme urgency or intensity, especially because of the great need or desire. I got to say this to our community and to the COCO communities. When the mayor and the president and the senators and all of them got up and said that gay marriage was the greatest day in the history of America, I wanted to vomit. And anyone who believes that, that calls himself a Christian, is not connected to the life of the church. It's not saying anything against gay people. I'm not saying anything against people who have some type of legal contractual commitment to each other. But to call marriage something other than that which God calls marriage is a little fox in the vine. And let me tell you something. You start communing with that attitude, it's a matter of time. You surround yourself with that attitude. People say, well, that's hate. That's not hate. It's not hate to rightly divide the truth. It is not hate to say it's this way. I cannot call Bruce Jenner's dog his cat. It's a dog. This is his flesh and blood. This is the church of the living God. And it's all of a sudden like these principalities and powers are putting so much weight on the church to conform to carnal appetites that we're not desperate enough for God to say, look, I love you if you believe that, but I can't agree with it. I love you if you want to believe that, but I cannot commune with that. I love you in your wrongness. I love you in your false theology, but that's not who I am. I am a son of the living God, and I must rightly divide truth. I'm sorry that people feel bad for people who think that they're something other than they are. And the church needs to pray for those people and love those people. But I'll be damned if I'm ever going to bring them up here and say, your husband and husband. And I sure can't say wife, because you have the wrong body parts for that. That doesn't mean I don't love all people. It just means I can't call a dog a cat. I can't call a pig a sheep. I can't call a bird a snake. And the principalities and powers in our educational system, at very young ages now, where they are saying we have to have 3 bathrooms instead of 2, or anybody can go into either one because they think they're something, because they don't want anybody else telling them. I'm sorry, I can't ignore it. I cannot be quiet. I can't be quiet about it. If this offends anybody here or listening, I don't know what to tell you. I'm not changing it. You need to think it through. You cannot take God's principles and modify them to accomplish secular humanism. You take secular humanism and modify it to accommodate God's order and God's plan. Otherwise, let's just say there is no God. You can't say God likes this contrary to God. You might as well just say there is no God. And I don't care how eloquently a person can articulate their falsehood, it's still false. I don't know why I'm on this, but I feel the Holy Ghost saying, man, somebody's got to declare it and quit trying to be so politically correct. Look, the church isn't going to grow anyway beyond what God wants it to grow. He will build his church. And the gates of hell will not prevail against it. Desperate, showing extreme courage, especially of actions courageously undertaken as a last resort. Showing extreme urgency or intensity, especially because of great need or desire. You know what happens when we're not desperate? We take things we don't agree with and we find a way to justify and tolerate. Even in other people. Well, they're just going through something. Well, that boy who went and killed those precious brothers and sisters in South Carolina was going through something. He was evil. But in his mind, he was doing something patriotic. Because we've twisted truth so much and tolerated all of this stuff. People do things in the name of something that's not true. Can I get an amen? Showing extreme urgency or intensity, especially because of great need or desire. Contrary to the way we view things, desperation is not a bad thing. And that's the first step the enemy wants to tell you. If you're right with God and you're being blessed by God, you won't be desperate. Tell that to the apostles who shed their blood for the kingdom. And as far as I'm concerned, those people in South Carolina are equal to every apostle who shed their blood for God. because they were at a prayer meeting and invited their killer to come in and sit with them like Jesus would, and were martyred there so that God could finally get the attention of CNN, Fox, NBC, ABC, the President of the United States, the senators, all of them. God bless their precious souls. May they have eternal rest in Christ, and may they be greatly rewarded for their love and kindness. See, what we call a racial thing is sometimes just an anti-Christ thing. There is no doubt in my mind there's racism in America, but there's prejudice on many levels. But this was an anti-Christ issue. Amen. Masked in racism. But it's still what it is. Demonic. We have let the world define things for us. Love. Truth. Faithfulness. And by the world's definition, desperation is a condition to be avoided at all costs. Because let me say something slowly and concisely. When you decide to live for God, part of your desperation is not accepting something you desire. Part of your desperation is not receiving something you desire. That's part of what desperation is. It's saying, you know what? This is going to satisfy me, but it's just too contrary to the God I serve. I love going to Zondo's church in South Africa because he talks to his people one way and he talks to visitors another way. And so when he gets to the end of his service, Zondo gets up there and he says, if you're sick in your body, and they have a sick room in the back with cameras and stuff back there, you got people with big sores. I'm talking oozing sores coming out of their eyes, and their bodies are being, their flesh is being eaten. And he's out there, and he'll say, he'll bring them out there. So bring the man out on a stretcher. They bring him out on a stretcher. He says to the man, he says, do you believe Zondo's God can heal you? He doesn't say God. He said, do you believe Zondo's God can heal you? How powerful. Jesus said, my Father. He didn't take credit for it. And for some reason, that activates the faith in these people. Can people say that about you? That your God? Your God has that kind of power? Or do people say about us, your God has no power because you live contrary to everything your God declares to be truth? It's a problem with preaching truth. It's tough. We say we want truth, but truth is exposing. It's like going under an X-ray. It's like a CAT scan. It's like exploratory surgery. And people today really don't want a church of truth. They want a church of entertainment. This is why Jesus only took three of them in to heal Tabitha. He said, this is too strong. I can't bring everybody in on this one. He said, this isn't for everybody. He brought the mother and the father and his three disciples, five, the number of grace, with him. You don't need to bring an offering for that. That's just free. Are y'all following me? God's ways of doing things are different than ours. He said, don't tell anybody about this. Whatever you do, don't mess this up with publicity. Thank you for all those amens, anyway. From a divine perspective, there are many blessings and even promises of God that cannot be obtained apart from being desperate. There's certain things you get from God out of desperation that you cannot get if you're not desperate for. We all should reach some measure of desperation concerning this huge gap between God, what God has made available to us and what God expects of us, compared to where we are actually at now. Every one of us could go do something this afternoon, make a decision that would make us more desperate for God. We won't, because we're too comfortable with our present state. I'm not saying that to be negative. We want God to give us the fruit of what desperation produces without being desperate. It's called divine desperation. Huh? That's why the scripture says you have been weighed in the balance. He talked about it. You've been weighed in the balance and found to be lacking. Amen? When we see the life that is available to us, and we see in our own lives and churches the low level of spiritual life and the absence of spiritual power, it should create a sense of emptiness within us. Mother looks at this Orthodox website that they have a special feature on there that it's newborns and little babies. I think they're infant children. And it shows them with an icon in their crib or them with their altar in their room. And it's really cool to look at it because like they're holding this big icon and kissing it. And because at least these parents are trying to expose their children to something other than Ninja Turtles. You know how I am by now. I don't think that's going to change anytime soon. A recognition of falling short of the glory. Sense of emptiness and a recognition of falling short of the glory that God has prepared for us. This should stir in us a sense of desperation. I was talking to Brother Steve yesterday. Some people look at cancer as a curse. Some people look at cancer as a gift. Guess it depends on how desperate for God you are. I guess that would determine whether it's a curse or a gift. Do you all understand that? Because if my God, if Gregory's God is big, anything that is brought to me is for God's use to glorify himself. Blessed are the desperate. Blessed are the desperate. Stand to your feet with me this morning. I don't think we can go take much more of this. Blessed are the desperate. Say that with me. Blessed are the desperate. Blessed are the desperate because the desperate will tear a roof off a house when it's necessary to get a paralytic down into the presence of God. The desperate won't walk up and say, well, just too crowded, we'll come another day. Deferring to the future what is lacked in the now. Blessed are the desperate, for they will push through the crowd to touch Jesus. Blessed are the desperate because they won't be offended. Even the dogs eat the crumbs from the master's table. Blessed are the desperate because they will break barriers, handle lepers, and touch women with issues of blood. Touch the church with her issue of blood. Blessed are the desperate, they'll give up dignity for an encounter with deity. Sometimes to have an encounter with deity, you got to give up your dignity. Zacchaeus, a well-known tax collector, had to give up his dignity in order to have Jesus into his house. Blessed are the desperate, for they will lay in the dirt, climb a tree, or jump in a lake to glorify God. Blessed are the desperate. They will not argue about what God does or how he does it. If he wants to make mud and put it in my eye, and that's the way he wants to heal me, then that's fine with me. Blessed are the desperate. For if it was not for them, the presence of the power of God would never have manifested in our fathers and in the church. It's not religion or ceremony or tradition, methods or programs, preaching or singing that brings the power of God into the church. It is a people desperate from God, for God, that brings the power into the church. It is a desperation for God that brings the power. Jesus said, "These works I shall do, and you also, and greater than these shall you do." And these signs shall follow them that believe in my name. They shall cast out devils. They shall speak with new tongues. If they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. And they shall lay their hands on the sick, and they shall recover. Jesus said, "You are the salt of the earth, the light of the world." The tremendous lack of doing the works of Jesus and the tremendous absence of spiritual presence in our lives, the absence of the spiritual gifts and the lack of desire for the gifts of the Spirit to be used for the work of Jesus, and it did not produce at least some measure of recognition or need of God's power to be manifest in our lives. The divine will of God would be that every one of us in this room and listening over the web would become desperate for an encounter with the power of Almighty God. Desperate beyond comfort, desperate beyond reputation, desperate beyond tradition, desperate beyond cosmetics, desperate beyond emotions, desperate beyond reason, and even desperate beyond good social fellowship with family and friends. Desperate enough to risk ridicule and failure. If you haven't risked anything, then you have never become desperate. Bow your heads. Father, I come before you with your people in this year of the Lord, 2015, knowing that the ancient fathers built the church out of desperation, famine, hunger, disease, persecution. Father, we know that when we become desperate, people will criticize us. We will lose a certain amount of religious standing. We will look at as to being overboard, extreme, unusual, weird. We know that being desperate for you, people will try to hold us down, shut us up. We know that we may get our fingers stepped on, like the woman with the issue of blood. And we know for sure we will get our feelings stepped on. Father, help us to become truly desperate, so that we can get what we are asking for. Blessed are the desperate, for they will do whatever it takes to get what God has promised them. I bless you all now in the name of the Father, and the Son, and life-giving Holy Spirit. Amen. Turn to two people and say, "Pray for me to become more desperate for God." Let us now profess our faith in Almighty God. We believe in one God,
the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and all things visible and invisible.